Welcome back to this YouTube channel, and once again it's time to crack open a family-sized can of delicious user-generated content. Right away I want to remind you that you are now morally obliged, ethically obliged, spiritually obliged, and indeed legally obliged to subscribe to this vlog. Right, not legally, but all of the others. And leave a comment to say that you've subscribed and share with the group your thoughts. Anyway, first up is the new movie from one of British film's brightest and most cinephilic talents, Edgar Wright's Last Night in Soho.
Last night, I saw something in my dreams. There was a girl.
And you are?
Sandy.
Last Night in Soho, scripted by Christy Wilson-Cairns, is a movie which wears its 60s retro connoisseurship on its sleeve. In fact, it's pretty much all over its snappy Lord John mohair suit. And maybe Edgar Wright wanted to do for 60s Soho what Tarantino did for 60s Los Angeles in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. And he does a very creditable job. Thomasin McKenzie plays a wide-eyed new fashion student called Ellie, who's brought her mum's old Dansett record player and Cilla Black and Petula Clark LPs up with her on the train from Cornwall to London. She has a fetish for what she imagines to be the lost, innocent glamour of the 1960s. Boring old modern-day London doesn't exactly measure up, but while moping in her manky bedsit, rented to her by a grumpy old landlady played by Diana Rigg, sadly now the late Diana Rigg, Ellie finds herself beset with nightly neon phantasms. She dreams her way through a time portal back into 60s Soho, where she witnesses a wannabe singer, Sandy, played by Anya Taylor-Joy, precisely the sort of retro showbiz princess she idolises, who is being exploited and abused by her sinister boyfriend-slash-manager, played by Matt Smith. Is Ellie having a breakdown, or is this actually happening? Last Night in Soho has a great opening act, and it's always very good, or at any rate very watchable, when it's in its 60s world, in the course of which it serves up an absolutely gorgeous period playlist on the soundtrack. But every time we switch back to 2021, the voltage and the interest drop. Thomasin McKenzie herself does a lot of pop-eyed, terrified staring and sitting bolt upright in bed after yet another actually happening bad dream. And by the time the third act rolls around, the movie's plot has lost quite a bit of oomph. The big reveal isn't that interesting, and often it simply isn't as scary as it's supposed to be. But none of that makes too much difference to the enormous style and pizzazz that Edgar Wright brings to directing his Soho world, a Valhalla of toxic glitz. You've heard of dramas, you've heard of docudramas, and of course you've heard of mockumentaries. But how to categorise, how to understand this next rather amazing film from the up-and-coming Mexican auteur Alonso Ruiz Palacios? Even the generic title is a challenge. It's called Una Película de Policias, or A Cop Movie.
Y sí, actuamos los policías. Podemos actuar con un perfil fuerte, un perfil débil. Fingimos dentro de la realidad, no fingimos dentro de la fantasía.
There's the trailer. It says it's a documentary. Is it? Two young Mexico City street cops, Teresa, played by Monica del Carmen, and Montoya, played by Raul Briones, partner up, hook up, and get affectionately nicknamed the Love Patrol. But then they come up against the corruption and disloyalty higher up the ranks and get bitterly disillusioned. It plays like a documentary, or even like a piece of experimental verbatim cinema in the style of Clio Barnard, with the actors sometimes lip-syncing to their own voiceover commentary during the scene. And then something else happens. The illusion collapses, the fourth wall falls, and the movie becomes something else. A documentary about the actors themselves and how they feel about immersing themselves, method style, in the world of the cops, how they feel about the police in general. And it's all in the style of video diaries filmed on people's phones. But wait, is this fictional too? This film, in the cleverest and yet also the most heartfelt way, is about what it takes for people in authority, particularly cops on the street, to put on an act. They have to make a theatrical display of their power, and we, the public, for our part, have to put on our act in obeying, or occasionally not obeying, the police. And where have cops and public learned this act? Why? From cop movies, of course. Can I once again now ask you to get your debit card out, familiarise yourself with the long card number on the front, the expiry date, and the three-digit CVC number on the signature strip, because it's time for you all to buy my book, The Films That Made Me. It's an edited selection of my essays and reviews for The Guardian. And for those of you thinking, surely that doesn't actually apply to me, I have to say, yes, it does apply to you. You'll feel better about yourself once you've bought it, I guarantee. Anyway, until next week, be seeing you.